episode 14.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for listening to the Just Forking Around podcast. And here's your host, Debbie Salzberg.
This episode is sponsored by Renew Juicery. I love Renew Juicery products, and you know I only endorse products and services that I personally have explored, ingested, worn, and truly love. Renew Juicery has a pantry product line that is available for shipment anywhere across the United States. Brooke Riva, founder, she is just phenomenal with her commitment and passion for creating a pure experience that will nourish your body, transform your skin, and awaken your taste buds. Her products are just top-notch, absolutely incredible. So go to renewjuicery.com, click on the pantry product line. And my recommendations, absolute favorites, the astragalus root powder, the pearl powder, and of course the ancient mineral salt. So astragalus has been used in traditional Chinese medicine for centuries. Its main use has been to boost the body's immune system, but it also has been used to treat and prevent heart disease. So since it's not super strong in taste, you can really toss it into anything. Smoothies, dash into tea, latte, tonics, add to homemade sauces. And the pearl powder, wow. I mean, that's all I can say about pearl powder. It's made from a preparation of crushed pearls below jewelry grade, and it is derived from ancient Chinese skincare. This powder has proven to help improve skin appearance and has been used in the cosmetics industry for centuries. So again, you can sprinkle into smoothies, dash into tonics, add to any baked goods as well. So renewjuicery.com, RenewJuicery.com. And as a special offer to you, the Just Forking Around podcast listeners, Renew Juicery is offering a 10%, yes, 10% discount on all pantry items. This is a great deal, and I'm so excited for all of you to explore Renew Juicery's pantry line. So when you go to renewjuicery.com, click on the pantry products offered, and then when at checkout, I want you to use this code. It's all in caps, Just Forking Around, JustForkingAround, Just Forking Around, to enjoy a 10% discount off your entire order. So enjoy, and remember, if you have not listened already to episode 001, please go check that out on the Just Forking Around podcast to learn all about Brooke Riva and Renew Juicery. Are you ready, Forking Nation, to win some really cool stuff for free from the Just Forking Around podcast? Yes, if you are ready, then simply participate in the contest. To participate in the Just Forking Around contest, simply answer the question at the beginning of every podcast. Go to the Just Forking Around website, which is justforkingaround.net. Scroll down the homepage and click on the contest button. Fill out your answer and voila, wait to win really cool stuff. So the month of May's winner, she's already been contacted. Are you ready? Drum roll, please. Sheila. Sheila from San Diego is the proud winner of a gift card, which I will announce to what San Diego restaurant she's going to be wine and dined at on episode 015. But for now, Sheila, congratulations, and please go ahead and fill out the answer to the contest question. Good luck.
This is Chris Lukey from Pubcast Worldwide. The Just Forking Around contest question is, one explanation of a church key states that most brewers in medieval times were monks. Lager cellars in the monasteries were locked to protect aging beers, and the monks carried keys to these lager cellars. It may have been those keys which resembled the early church key door openers that gave way to naming the church key. What is the more common name of a church key, which so many bartenders consider part of their uniform?
If you've seen the weight loss success of Jessica Simpson, Katie Couric, Jennifer Hudson, and Charles Barkley, then you are familiar with Liz Josefsberg's work. Spending over 15 years in the weight loss industry, Liz is all about helping people transform their lives. And not just celebrities have seen results. She has been featured on national network television programs such as Good Morning America, The Dr. Oz Show, The Oprah Winfrey Show, and many others. Over the past 15 years, Liz has learned the secrets, tips, and tricks for successful weight loss and keeping that weight off. She herself has lost 65 pounds and continues to successfully keep that weight off. So I am so excited to discover more about Liz Josefsberg, her latest endeavor, Target 100, and what it takes to stay healthy and some cooking tips and tricks and recipes. So without further ado, welcome Liz Josefsberg.
Thank you, Debbie. Thanks for that great intro. I'm so glad to be here today.
Excellent. I'm so happy you're here. Thanks for taking the time. So let's do this. Let's start off with a toast to get this podcast started. In my glass, I am raised I have sparkling San Pellegrino, a little sparkling water. So I'm going to raise my glass to you. And do you have something you can toast with and then maybe do the honors of the toast?
I do. I have a little seltzer myself, which I'm addicted to. I am always trying to keep everyone hydrated, so I'm glad you're drinking water as well.
Yes.
And I'm raising that glass to you and to everyone out there listening, maybe picking up one small piece of information today that makes their lives healthier.
Ah, cheers. Here. Cheers.
Thank you.
All right. So Liz Josefsberg, you can find her and all of her social media platform connections at lizjosefsberg.com, LizJosefsberg.com. So Liz, I touched very briefly on your background. Can you just fill us in a wee bit more on your life that that has brought you to this current mark in time?
Sure. Interestingly enough, I'm deep into my second career in life. Prior to the weight loss career that I've crafted over the last 15 years, I was actually a professional actress and was in Broadway musicals and things like Les Miserables and Showboat for many years, and then was always struggling with my weight. And as an actress, that was a very difficult thing because your body is under scrutiny pretty much all the time. So as I rotated out of that career and ended up going to Weight Watchers to actually lose some weight that I had gained, it ended up changing my life. And I ended up working for the company and working my way up through the company, helping in pretty much every role imaginable. And it was interesting. The reason I bring up the piece about the acting career was that acting career really lent itself to my overall success because I ended up helping the CEO of WeightWatchers.com at the time lose about 40 pounds.
Wow.
And then that began, as you can imagine, quite an intimate relationship. But whenever you help somebody lose weight, I mean, there's so much to uncover. So it really was the beginning of my understanding that weight loss for me is almost not about food at all, because I've never seen anyone who didn't know that they should choose the apple over the candy bar. They know, but they have trouble getting there. So that was sort of where that was born, was in that sort of these one-to-one relationships that, you know, it started with the CEO of Weight Watchers. And then as celebrities came looking for help at Weight Watchers, they couldn't follow the traditional trajectory and go to meetings weekly, you know, at Weight Watchers. So I ended up designing a sort of, like, we called it like the black ops level of Weight Watchers, where I personally went to them and took care of them and taught them and shopped with them and cooked with them and really helped them transform their lives. And again, it wasn't about the fact that these are highly intelligent people who have resources and they still are having trouble making those decisions. So again, it just reinforced that, you know, this is this is not just about food. This is about so many other things. So that acting background came in handy as I helped those celebrities. I ended up all over national TV and ended up, you know, co-hosting Dr. Oz for a season with him as we tried to transform America's weight issue in a season-long collaboration between Weight Watchers and Dr. Oz. And so that acting background really helped sort of kind of propel my career. And then I spent about 11 years at Weight Watchers, as I say, running and doing pretty much every job imaginable there, from marketing to their national spokesperson to helping celebrities. The entire time I was there, all 11 years, I remained active on the meetings level. And I led, you know, 7 to 10 Weight Watchers meetings a week in New York City. Even though I would had to fly every week to LA, I would still keep my meetings in New York so that I was helping people on every level of life, right? Like celebrity to a working mom, to a corporate CEO. So I could really get a feeling for what was going on. So thousands and thousands of people. And then including myself, you know, losing 65 pounds and trying in this difficult environment to keep them off. It's been a really interesting journey. And I think probably my empathy and understanding of what it is to carry weight and to need to lose weight and to try to keep that weight off has made my voice resonate for people. It's different than, you know, hiring a trainer who's in peak physical condition and has no idea what it feels like to be overweight and all of the mental stuff that goes along with that. Yeah. So
that's important. You talk a lot about the pain of gaining and losing weight over and over again. It just is something that seems like you can relate with to your clients, which is exactly what you just touched on, which is huge with trainers. Sometimes, you know, the trainers may not ever have known what that feels like. So you can really understand and get in there on a level that, you know, is extremely powerful.
Yeah. Well, I think I find that it really relaxes someone when they, if I have sort of like a tagline of mine is that you're not broken. Oftentimes I'll come to someone, you know, I have a private client business now. I left Weight Watchers about 3 years ago, realizing that I had become kind of like a Weight Watchers expert, but not a weight loss industry expert. So I left there about 3.5 years ago and started consulting all over the industry. Everywhere from high-end fitness clubs like Lifetime Fitness to, you know, United Healthcare to wearable technologies and these really forward-thinking like breath analysis devices that are going to, you know, be kind of the wave of the future, telling you if based on chemicals in your breath, if you're actually losing weight or not. So it became really important to me to get outside of just Weight Watchers and become sort of this weight loss industry expert and build this private client business. And as I say, I sit down with somebody and I'll tell them there's nothing wrong with you. And it's like a lot of times tears just come for people because they're like, wait, I'm a highly successful business person. I can tackle everything in my life, but this thing keeps me confused and keeps me feeling badly about myself. And when I start to talk to them about the fact that this is basically a bunch of habits and behaviors that need to be unraveled, and not a magical food plan that gets handed to them, and start to teach them about the fact that the environment we live in is literally triggering them to eat all the time.
Yeah.
And we talk in my program, you mentioned Target 100 is a book that I've written that's coming out in December of this year. And it's based on these sort of 15 years and thousands of people in my own experience. Is we have so many bad habits and so many triggers, and weight loss is not about just food, but of course movement and exercise, but hydration, stress, and sleep. So I don't really want people to think like there's just this magical food plan, and if only I would follow this food plan, everything would be fine. Because if you don't start to address these other pillars of like the quality of your sleep and how much sleep you're getting or the stress that you're under, the hormone imbalances are going to drive you to eat anyway, even if you do everything right, it won't matter. So if you don't get all of this stuff in place, it's sort of like you can join a weight loss program and follow their advice. But if you don't look at other pillars, you'll end up going back over and over again.
I was reading a little bit about the 5 points that you talk about and hydration, sleep, stress. I mean, those are all factors that people don't take into consideration when they're on a program or not even on a program, just trying to live life as they are and maintain, you know, a healthy lifestyle. And are some of the technologies I know that you were, that you're part of or that you have studied the technology, but the one of them I found to be interesting, I forget the name of it, but it's with the breath or the, you breathe in to something and it will, and it actually moment to moment takes into consideration if you're burning calories or if you're losing weight or if you're gaining. Are you still part of that technology, that company?
So I have been helping, it's a technology company out of Seattle called Level, it's L-E-V-L, and they are in the process of developing what's called a breath analysis device. And the device itself, you breathe in it in the morning and maybe at night before you go to bed. It may sit in your bathroom or on your countertop. And it's just a tiny little breath pod that you take a deep breath and you breathe into it, place it back into the container, and it does a reading on the chemicals that are in your breath. So when you're actually doing a weight loss program or following a regimen or trying to lose weight and you're restricting your calories or eating sort of like a diet that would produce weight loss, you have a chemical in your breath called acetone that gets released. And I always say this, the science department doesn't like it, but I think it makes it more understandable for the layman. It's basically when your fat cells are being used or being sort of broken open, there's a chemical that escapes through your breath that the higher it is in concentration, the more fat you're actually losing at that time. So I think this is so important because in the weight loss industry before this, you were standing in the dark. You were like, am I losing weight? I can get on the scale, but that's such a delayed reaction. Like, it doesn't tell me what's happening right now. Right. It tells me maybe it's a snapshot of what's happened over the last week of my life. And I don't know if it was the meal I had yesterday or the exercise I did, but this tells you sort of in the moment is what you're doing with your exercise and your eating working.
Wow, that's incredible.
So and coming into the market. And I think it's just going to be one of those things that, you know, right now it's that sort of early adopter or that person who's really interested in science and technology that would get interested in this. But I think we'll look back in like 15 years and we'll go, you know, wow, I can't believe we weren't looking at genetic testing, DNA, you know, all of these different things that are going to blow the doors right off of weight loss. You know, I think within 15 years, you won't do a weight loss program if you don't take a genetic test first, because your genetics, you know, may say that a high fat diet is better for you and that you should be doing powerlifting, whereas the woman standing next to you should be a vegetarian doing yoga.
Right.
And we don't know right now. So we all dab in the dark and we try things. Technology and science are going to be incredibly fast moving in the next, you know, 15 years.
I love that. And you're super like a pioneer in kind of like integrating from all your past experience with Weight Watchers and the meetings and, you know, working with Dr. Oz and just everything all of the culmination of everything you've experienced over the past 15 years and then taking into consideration now the technology. I mean, that's cool. That's like sort of unprecedented, I think. As I was researching a little bit about you and what you're involved in, I found that to be quite unique. I don't know. Is that accurate? Is that something that...
It's very true. That's sort of where my career has ended up. And now I consult again. I consult around the industry with mainly like these great, amazing, forward-thinking Silicon Valley tech gurus who are building. I just am starting a great gig with a new device that's called the Shape-A Scale. And what's so interesting is that we need to change behavior, not food choices. We can do that. That's easy. But can we change behavior, right? So the scale, I think the scale for most people can be a really negative experience. So these guys kind of pioneered this scale that does not have any numbers. Instead, you get on the scale for about 10 days to 2 weeks. This is an amazing, beautiful device that sits on the floor. It doesn't even look like a scale. And it doesn't shoot a number back at you, even for the first 2 weeks, because what they've realized is if we could just get you to get on it and let us collect some really interesting information about you and put that back to you in a more of a holistic advice kind of behavior modification program, that's way more impactful than anyone just trying to follow a food plan.
Wow, that's so cool.
And I checked all of these. The reason that I think my career is going in this direction is that I live the life of the consumer. I am her. I'm a 46-year-old woman who fights to keep her weight off after two kids. I love Chardonnay. Like, you're never going to see me give up my chocolate. Okay, so I figure out what it is that'll keep me moving forward. So I tested this scale and was like, what an interesting thought, because I've seen so many of my clients get so thrown off. You know, they get a good number on the scale, so they think they can eat more. They get a bad number on the scale, they believe they're a bad person. They should eat because it doesn't matter anyway. So that scale is determining their behavior. So if we take the number away, what could we actually achieve? So I started using this, and I still, to this day, I don't love getting on the scale because it's so erratic and different, and who knows what's driving it, you know, from one day to the next. You can see these massive swings. Mm-hmm. From morning till night, you can see a massive swing. And I started stepping on it, and it's amazing when there's no negative coming back at you, and yet you know that it's just recording. And this scale is amazing. It's recording 7 different indicators of, like, everything from your body fat percentage to your actual weight to inflammation to hydration levels, all of this through this little scanner on the feet.
Wow.
And I was like, oh, I'll get on this thing like 2-3 times a day. And so, because they love you to get on it more than once a day, because you do have these massive fluctuations during the day, the scale uses artificial intelligence to actually take that information and pull it together into a profile, you know, and then it tells you just based on like a color and a range of like, okay, you're headed in the right direction, and then delivers a behavior modification for you to work on either that day or that week, right? So it could be something as simple as, you know, yes, add a glass of water into your day at 4 p.m. and helps you set an alarm on your phone to trigger you to drink that water. So we're learning to change behavior based on artificial intelligence through technology at this point. And I find that to be amazing, because if I could be in everyone's pocket the way that I am with my private clients, I have a high-end private client business where I take just a very small handful of people and I'm with them 24/7 through text, phone. So if they end up at a restaurant, they text me and say, I'm sending you a picture of this menu, tell me what to eat. I can help them in the moment.
Yeah.
If technology could take that over, right? If GPS could say, I see that you are in this restaurant, here are the best 3 things you could order off of this menu, then we could really make changes in this obesity epidemic that's sort of sweeping the world.
I'm just trying to, you know, put my arms around that scale, that new technology, and that just the things that just came to my mind were like, when I get on a scale, you know, I could get on a scale in the morning, and then I can get on the scale a few hours later, and the fluctuation, the variation, you know, I might be bloated or I might be carrying water or whatever it is, and I get crazy in my brain, you know, I get like, oh my God, like, what have I done in the past few hours to have gained like 2 pounds? You know, it's crazy. And so, and I find that the more sometimes I'll go onto the scale, the more frustrating, but then the more I keep going onto a scale, because it's just this weird mental game of getting on the scale, even though I know I maybe not gained 2 pounds in like 4 hours, but I keep seeing, because I feel like the numbers are right. I don't know. And then I want to like reset the scale on the tile. Maybe it was the tile. And then I get back on and I'm like, okay, it's a pound less. And then, so when I think about this, the brilliance of that technology with the scale you're referring to, it just makes so much more sense, because it seems like it's something that would be more motivating. It seems something that's more uplifting. It makes just so much more sense. It's almost like, wow, what have we been doing all these years?
You know what's so interesting? They've discovered in the last year, by looking at brains under an MRI brain scan, that when we feel the emotions of either guilt or shame, which the scale is famous for making us all feel, when you feel those emotions of guilt and shame, the reward center of the brain gets lit up. So if you've ever had that experience of like having a bad weigh-in and then going and eating your face off, you're doing exactly what you're meant to do, which is you've had a bad result. And so the brain lights up your reward center. And for most of us, our favorite reward and the most easily accessible reward is food. So the diet industry, from my perspective, has been set up to make us fail, not on purpose. We didn't know this. We didn't know this information. You know, you think about any diet out there, it's built on this sort of finite number of calories. And if you go over that number, your app turns red or you've now blown it. Yeah. And I see this all the time at Weight Watchers. Like if somebody went over their allotted number of points, they would immediately freak out and they would be off the rails for until they came back in for their next weigh-in, which they felt like was like a reset button. For me, weight loss is a mental game. And once you realize that you have to drop these feelings of guilt and shame, which this scale does so beautifully because it takes that away, but if you expand that into your lifestyle efforts, and I'll start off with clients and try to teach them this, like, and they'll be like, I don't even understand what you mean, Liz. Like, what do you mean? I said, like, if you make a perceived mistake, right, you end up, you're packing the kids' lunches and you pop a cookie in your mouth, one for them, one for me, right? That seems to be, for me, that was the end of my day, right? That was it. I was now off the rails and I would eat poorly for the rest of the day. They've actually learned that looking at the brain again under a brain scan, that you can actually reverse that reward center by just being grateful. So the act of gratitude, like actively being grateful for something, can stop that reaction in its tracks. So I always say, like, now if something happens, like I didn't plan on popping that cookie in my mouth, I'll literally stop and I'll just think of three things I'm grateful for in the moment to stop myself from doing the old thing, which is just eating all day long. So maybe I'm grateful it was just one cookie and not six. Right. And
so switching, it's almost like you're switching the, I don't know, the technical, the neurotransmitters or maybe thoughts that would normally go in one direction. It's almost like you're present and you're actively switching the direction. So it kind of gives a new habit or a new direction. Wow, that's amazing.
I love to like think of it like a train track. You know, when you, in the old days, if you pulled that lever and the train went a different direction, that's what putting gratitude in will do. And I know it sounds so simple and almost so like, what? Like this, but it's literally life changing because they've noticed that with gratitude, even the act of searching for three things that you're grateful for releases so much serotonin and dopamine and endorphins that it's almost to the level of like an antidepressant. Wow. So if you even starting, like, isn't this funny? Like, yes. You know, a healthy breakfast could be like a Greek yogurt and some raspberries. Fantastic. It's got fat. It's got raspberries. It's got fruit. It's got protein in the yogurt. Wonderful. If you could eat these healthy foods, you know what they are. But could you get over the brain game that is going to get in the way of that every time? Then you could really have success because you know what to eat, how you manage to get there each time.
Right. No, that's powerful. Because like you said in the beginning, you know that the candy bar versus the apple, I mean, we know what is a better choice, but actually kind of executing sometimes is the challenge. So I know that we talked in the beginning a little bit about celebrities, and I do just have to ask a couple quick questions about celebrities, just since that is a big part of your history and your current client base. So can you share a memorable moment or two that you're so proud of with a celebrity transformation?
Gosh, you know, the celebrities, to me, I think the most important thing that I'm always trying to get people to understand is that I think people really believe or want to believe that a celebrity has it easier in some way because of perhaps the amount of money they have or the resources they have. But there is no difference. If I could just give you like that as like lay the groundwork. These are just people. And they're struggling just like you. And in fact, I think the thing I'm proudest of is helping them to navigate a really difficult lifestyle, right? I think people don't understand. The celebrities that I've worked with are literally the hardest working people I've ever met. And they are famous because of that. So you have to imagine that these people, like take Jennifer Hudson, right? She has maybe gotten up that day at 5 in the morning, maybe flown for 3.5 hours, gotten immediately off the airplane, put into a car in a different time zone. It's not like she has a chef making her breakfast. They want Jennifer on set, ready to go. And she has to figure out how to fly at 5 a.m, arrive there, have the right food, be energetic. She doesn't even have time for a workout.
Wow.
She's often in a different city every single day. She is, you know, doing one day she's recording, one day she's doing a movie scene, one day she's here. Their lifestyle is unbelievable. And then on top of it, you have to layer on the piece that everyone in their lives wants to make them happy, right? So I had the chance to travel with Jennifer to South Africa when she was filming the movie Winnie, because we were just getting started on her weight loss, and we were really learning about what it would be to travel to another country where you don't recognize one thing, really. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. This is, again, like, here she's starting her weight loss journey, and a month and a half in, she has to go spend 3.5 months in a country she's never been in with food she's never seen before. And so those kinds of things are all new and different in a totally new time zone, filming all day long. Sometimes they film through the night because it's a night scene. They've got to film all night long. You know, her clock is so off. The thing about it, everyone around her wants to make her happy. So, like, we'd be sitting there and someone would literally walk into a photo shoot and they'd be like, "Oh, I'm so happy to meet you, Jennifer. I brought you a box of Godiva chocolate." Right. And the box is like something you've never seen in your life. Oh. Like, and to you said, like, what are those moments that make you proud? Jennifer opens that box. She picks out her absolute favorite one. She closes the box, hands it to the crew, says, "Please eat these for me," while she sits and enjoys the one piece of candy. Mm-hmm. And so the skills that are lifelong, healthy lifestyle skills are those. It's not that she doesn't eat the chocolate, but it's that she manages and learns how to deal with every kind of situation with both moderation and balance. Mm-hmm. But I guess I hope people know that,
yeah.
You know, I'm thinking about, like, Charles Barkley right now, like, he's in the finals for the NBA, and he has to fly from city to city. You know, they keep moving every day. They move to a different city, make it fair. He's flying all over the place. The minute he lands, he has 45 radio interviews to do. Nobody's looking out for what he's going to eat. They want him on the radio and on TV. He's got to figure it out. And then they've got him all night backstage. There's a huge buffet of very unhealthy food, alcoholic beverages, all this stuff that he has to kind of sit there and look at all night,
wow.
Which those of us in our living rooms, we don't have to deal with that at night while we watch the game.
Right. It's true. No, it's true. I mean, and then on top of that, the paparazzi and the scrutiny and the photos and all that. So they're under extreme duress to maintain that level of fitness and visual, you know, attractiveness.
Absolutely. Yes.
Wow. Incredible. If you opened up Katie Couric's refrigerator, when you had been maybe working with her at that time, what would we see in there? What would be the top items we would see in, say, Katie Couric's refrigerator?
Yeah, well, and Katie's a great example, because she actually, you know, lives in New York, and often she works in New York most of the time too, right? She still has to travel all the time, but so she could actually sometimes even come home for lunch and things like that. So her fridge is very stocked. The thing I teach pretty much everyone, top to bottom, right to left, is just filling that fridge. If, you know, if you're going to cook something, cook double, right? So if you have a favorite recipe, like I have a favorite meatball recipe, or we have these amazing iron skillet chicken recipes, we don't make one batch of it. We make two batches and we save it to be used throughout the week. Same thing with grains, healthy grains. So Katie's fridge would probably have like a big Tupperware filled with quinoa or bulgur, with a measuring cup inside of that, a plastic measuring cup inside of the Tupperware, so that she could just then at lunch go home and grab some greens, half a cup of her bulgur, and some of the chicken from last night, and be set with a healthy meal. I think you'd see tons of fruits and vegetables in there, but not in their whole state, right? I always say the difference between opening your fridge to see a watermelon or cut up watermelon are two different things,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, definitely.
Well, hers would be filled with tons of prepared fruits and vegetables, easy to grab, easy to make, lots and lots of sparkling water and fresh cut up limes, because again, you just want to make it appealing to yourself so that you will do that, maybe over grabbing that Diet Coke, right? So it's always about taking that one extra step. And, you know, today, even in my life, like my husband just went to Costco and we'll do like, take the organic chicken breasts, throw them into Ziploc bags with, you know, olive oil, balsamic vinegar, and a bunch of spices, marinate that. But we will make, you know, he'll fire up the grill tonight and we'll make 10 chicken breasts. Yeah. And we'll use those. It's, you know, low carb chicken quesadillas. We'll use them over salad. We'll use them. We'll send them for my kids' lunches, like sliced up on a piece of bread. We just use it throughout the week. And that way there's never a barrier to me being able to grab a healthy meal. Right. I think that's the key, having stuff on hand.
Definitely. I definitely agree. That's interesting with Katie Couric, because she does live and work in New York as well. So it does make it probably a little bit more convenient. What about your refrigerator? Well, you just described a little bit about we could transition into recipes as well. Like what types of food or bread or what type of vegetables do you have? How do you prepare them? What kind of tips could you give us all on that? Yeah.
Well, in my book, you know, the nutrition part of the book is called Target 100, because I've come up with a program that is based off the number 100 in each one of those pillars. So nutrition, we're looking at just 100 grams of carbs in a day. So if we start there, I don't believe in extreme anything. So 100 grams of carbs is a very livable number of carbohydrates in a day. But what it does is it forces you to kind of turn labels over and look at like what is in something. The reason I'm pushing people and I keep myself away from carbs in this new sort of food environment that we live in is that the carbohydrates are often, so if you look under the carbohydrates part of the label, it's delineated into sugars and things like that. So sugar lives in the carbohydrates, and a lot of our foods are being filled with sugar. And sugar tends to lead to cravings and overeating and the desire to eat more. So I'm not a carb hater. I love carbs, but I want you eating your carbs in vegetables, fruits, you know, really getting it where you should, not in processed foods.
Right,
so
by
reducing carbs, you have to reduce processed foods. Mainly in my fridge, that's what you would see is like, I try to eat full fat dairy because again, if you remove the fat from the dairy, they replace it with sugar. Lots of eggs. I eat probably eggs if they're not like a couple of hard boiled eggs. I'll make an omelet in the morning. I'll do, you know, lots and lots of fresh vegetables.
Do you use whites or do you use both? I'm curious about that.
Oh, this is something I wish everyone would know this. Like, go for the full fat dairy, stop with the low fat and the fat free stuff. You know, going for 2% or whole dairy is going to be your best bet. You will be fuller. It's more delicious. You will not crave things. Same thing with eggs. Eggs got a really bad rap. We had a lot of bad stuff that happened in the 80s, which number one was we started to take fat out of our foods because we thought we were getting fat from eating fat. And all of that was wrong.
Yeah.
The fat and then removing the fat and replacing it with sugar actually spiked our diabetes problem like hundreds and hundreds of a percent over the last 25 years. So I'm trying to return you to your full fat dairy. Again, another big error that they made was believing that our cholesterol is raised by cholesterol in foods, where it is not. So food sources, the newest research, the kind of the cutting edge research is that, you know, you don't get high cholesterol from eating eggs. There's no correlation. So all of that, the fear that was around eggs, all of the good stuff, the choline and the things that you need, the fat burning properties of eggs are all in the yellow. So we made a huge mistake going to egg white.
That's huge. That's like reverse. I mean, it's the opposite, right? I mean,
yeah. So when I sit down with a client for the first time and I tell them you're going to eat full fat cheese, eggs, you know what I mean? They're like, what? I'm like, we're going to have a little bit of chocolate, dark chocolate every day. Like, they're like, what? What? Yeah, no, I believe in loving what you eat and loving food because it is the way to feeling better and sometimes even healing disease. And it's so important.
I'm just curious, when you were growing up, what was it like at your dinner table? I know that might be going back a little bit, but I'm just really curious.
Yeah. I was a Midwestern child, and we ate meat and potatoes. Like, never forget. Like, my dad was, and what's so funny is my dad was a vascular surgeon who ended up having a sextuple bypass to his heart, just, you know, smoking, drinking, like, very unhealthy lifestyle. But we ate, you know, lots and lots of potatoes and meat at my dinner table as a child. So,
did you all, were you all together? Was it a family driven, or was it kind of wet will? Like, there was always food and you just kind of grazed when you were hungry?
No, it was very much a sit down together at dinner, which I've kind of preserved that with my kids as well. Like, I make a really big effort. It's so interesting. I've really been working a lot with families at this point because this environment is so tough. But we've worked so hard in my home to sit down to dinner together most nights of the week. And, you know, with sporting events and all the rest of it, we can't do it every day. But we try, because it's really the only time in our busy lives now that we sit down and really talk to one another without a screen, without, you know, anything.
Yeah, right.
And there's so much research that ties sitting down to a meal, to a plate that's been, you know, served on a table and having no distractions. Like, they say you'll eat 30% more just by eating with any sort of a screen or phone nearby. So, you know, if you're wanting to cut back, probably, you know, the biggest thing you could do for yourself is get the mail off of the dining room table, set that table, and start sitting down at it and eating off of, you know, off of a nice plate and a small plate, much smaller than most of us are eating off of now. These are those sort of behavior modifications that I was talking about that I work with my clients on. I think, like, I'm thinking of one of my clients who has a very hectic life, and he works about 10 minutes from home, and his work is just very social and very driven. And then he has about a 10-minute drive, and he walks in the door to 3 children who all have sporting events and things like that, and his wife and everybody grabbing first time. And he would walk through the door, and his habit or his behavior was to simply put his bag down and go straight to the fridge and start eating standing up out of the fridge.
Wow.
So I changed his pathway into the home. He started coming through the front door rather than the kitchen side door. He came in through the front door. He dropped his bag, filled up a cup of water, and immediately went upstairs and got out of his work clothes and took 10 minutes to decompress. Then he went downstairs and they all ate dinner together. And literally the weight started falling off of him because he was finally not taking in an extra 500 calories standing in front of the fridge that he didn't even remember he was eating.
Mm-hmm.
Eating out of stress. We hydrated him and changed his entrance into the home. Those are more important than me saying you need to eat some baby carrots.
Right, right. Put baby carrots in there. So when you come in and you're standing there, you're going to choose that over this, which is probably not going to happen, right? So you change the whole. That's brilliant. I mean, that just makes sense. And I think that's something that we all can, like, kind of think about. Maybe our behaviors and just change just a teensy bit, you know, just the direction. Yeah. That's brilliant. I love that.
And think about how positive that is, right? Like, he can see that he did that. He can mark that off of a behavior change. And I tell you, it's very difficult to do. He wouldn't even remember to do it for the first couple of days that we were trying to do it. So we had to actually set an alarm on his phone that went off somewhere in the range of about 5 minutes before he usually would get home that said, go in the front door.
Wow. That's habitual, because it's so habitual, his, you know, walking in and doing through the side door.
Yeah. So it's like those kinds of, if you really want to think about changing your life, sure, surely healthy whole foods, non-processed foods, yes. Cooking meals, learning to sit down and eat meals. But none of this happens overnight either. I think that's this horrible thing that's been perpetuated in the weight loss industry, is like this before and after picture. You know, like, people didn't realize, Jennifer Hudson and I were working together for like a year. They thought it was like 15 minutes.
Right. Right.
She was working so hard for so long, and just people didn't see her. She just wasn't in the spotlight. And when it was time for her to kind of step out and show off the weight loss, it looked to everyone as if it had been overnight.
Right.
That's incredible. Wasn't overnight. That's the other thing. Like these people, the before and after photo shoots that you're seeing from these weight loss companies, it's probably the most detrimental thing that you could ever look at, because there's just a before and an after right next to each other. But in between those two pictures was a lifetime of changes of behavior. So if you can start to understand that and be proud of yourself for where you are and see what it is that you're working on now, then it's a whole different, you know, I try to make this so much fun and such a discovery and such a journey of change. I try to change that the whole way that you think about weight loss, which may have been negative or punishing. This should be exciting. This should be like, what am I going to do this week? You know, right. Like what little tiny shift could I make? Could I start using a smaller plate? You know, research shows you'll eat 30% less. If you ate 30% less at every meal for the next week of your life, you'll lose weight and you won't even feel it because you just had a smaller plate.
Right. That's incredible. I mean, that, and that could just is a great segue right into you have a really cool retreat coming up in July and in Tuscany at Villa Monte Castelli, which, as you know, I love Monte Castelli. I've been there before. I know the family that owns that. And I can you just tell us that's just I get chills thinking about that because that's just going to be spectacular. So tell us a little bit about that Tuscan mind and body retreat.
Yes. So this is at this gorgeous, unbelievable, like I would call it like a reconstructed castle in Tuscany, just outside of Florence. And amazingly enough, it's very interesting. I went to Italy 2 years ago and it changed my life, like further changed my life. Just the way that they approach food, the way that they approach family, the way that they live life in the present. And I was there with my family and I said at the time, I said, my dream is to bring people here in the future to get well.
I love that.
I was like, I just know that I want to start bringing people here for retreats. I didn't think much more about it. And then I ran a boot camp in my backyard for some local women trying to kind of, I'm also a personal trainer, so I do some boot camp style stuff. And I was just really enjoying, I had like a 12-week boot camp going on. And this woman who was in there with me pulled me aside and she said, hey, Liz, you know, would you ever consider teaching at a Tuscan castle a week of wellness? And I was like, oh my God, my dream just came true.
Yeah. That's awesome.
And this is Amy. I don't know if you have met Amy before.
Yeah, Amy from that does the imports for, I've spoke with her on the phone because I've purchased some of the olive oil from the Monte Castelli. Yes, Amy, A-I-M-E-E, I think she spells her name.
Yes. And she is just fantastic. She was like, she's like, I book weeks in this unbelievable castle. And it's got a 1,000-year-old pizza oven. It has an olive grove of olive, you know, bulbs that they found as they rebuilt the castle and they make olive oil there. And she's like, it's luxury. And you could, as long as you, you know, if you'd like to, we'll help you with, you know, bringing people there. So this summer will be my first one from July 29th to August 5th. Will be a retreat where basically every day we'll wake up and do some exercise together. I'll be leading an exercise class. Then we will do in the lilac grove or in the lavender grove, we'll do a meditation because I really, really believe in stress relief and meditation and teaching people how to relieve stress through meditation. So each day they'll be working out, then we'll be doing meditation, then we'll be doing healthy meals. The staff there will be making healthy meals for us. We'll be doing cooking classes, so some healthy cooking classes there on site. We'll be making olive oil, and then we'll be visiting some local towns and three different local towns that we'll be going to explore, and then we'll be going to some restaurants that we would never see sort of without the direction of the staff at Monte Castelli. And we're going to go to some wineries.
Excellent.
And it's really, for me, it's all about the way that I believe that you get to the healthiest lifestyle, which is with some hard work, right? We're going to meditate. We're going to exercise. We're going to do some walking during the day, but that we're also going to learn how to cook really beautiful food and even indulge correctly throughout the week. And I'll be leading four different classes during the week that people attend. And then I'll do personal one-to-one coaching. Each person gets two coaching sessions and a massage.
Wow.
So this is very full.
You, and it's a limited amount of people that you're taking with you in spots. And I think that there's, as of this moment, and we're hopefully going to probably fill that shortly, but there is a spot or two open. Unless I jump on one of those, I want to go back.
Yeah, I know, right? Are you sure you don't want to come with me?
I know. Amazing. It's so special there. That's going to be absolutely spectacular. I feel like that there's the land that Monica Castelli, the villa is on, is extremely magical. And just the whole grounds, everything, the animals, it's going to be phenomenal. Phenomenal. Yeah. I have chills when I said that.
How incredible that they raise on an organic farm. Absolutely everything that we will eat will come from this organic farm and the animals that they raise on site. Like, I think that's one of the biggest teachings for me, and this will be so powerful to show the way in which, unfortunately, the American food supply has deteriorated. I often will have clients go to Europe and they'll say, they're so concerned. Oh, I know I'm going to drink wine in France, and I know I'm going to eat some bread and some chocolate, and they come back and they've lost 5 pounds.
Yes. and they didn't sacrifice any flavor, any taste or anything. And
asking why. And I'm like, because none of that food has been genetically modified. Like, people don't really understand that a lot of what we're eating in this country is downright toxic at this point. And our bodies don't even know how to react to it. So, you know, I'll take people over there and they'll have gluten intolerance problems here in the US, and they can eat anything over there because the wheat has not been modified. So their bodies can handle it. Like, our bodies just don't know what's going on here. So it'll be wonderful. Yeah.
It's going to be amazing. It's just going to be so fun. And I'm sure that Jens and Barb and the staff over there are going to be extremely excited to have you all there and celebrating food and culture and wine and olive oil.
Yeah. Help.
Yes. Oh my God, it's amazing. So Liz, this was just a chock full of incredible information, and I am so excited to perhaps have you back on the show a little bit later to see really how once the Target 100 is actually going to be, you're doing pre-orders now for the book, is that?
Not quite yet, but if you sign up for my newsletter on my website, which is just LizJosefsberg.com, you'll definitely be getting a note about how to pre-order that book when it's coming out.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your time. I know you're super busy. You have a lot going on, and I'm excited to watch your trajectory. And again, I'm going to have all in the show notes and everything all available for the for your luxury Tuscan mind and body retreat at Monica Castelli, and for the lucky ones that are able to commit and go and take that step to health and wellness and great wine. That's going to be fun. Thank you so much, Liz.
Thanks so much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. Hey, everybody. I hope you enjoyed listening to that episode. And again, please rate and review if you did like this podcast episode or any of the other ones. Please go to iTunes, download, rate, review. I appreciate that very much. Just Forking Around Podcast. And again, I am Debbie Salzberg. My handle on Instagram is @ForkingPodcast. My website is justforkingaround.net. And I am so excited to have you on board here with me on the Just Forking Around podcast, and I look forward to seeing you on the next show.